Hello, I hope you're doing well, staying healthy, and everything's going okay. I miss having you in class. I decided to up my video game, and I have to thank Mr. Bowman for that. Also, he inspired me to grow this mustache to help improve my social distancing. I think it's working. Not a lot of people coming around me. So thanks again, Mr. Bowman.
It's.
Don't panic. No, not yet.
So we're going to walk through some of the notes that had you write down into your notebook. And hopefully, you know, kind of hearing some talking over them helps with some of the ideas. So we've been looking at evolution and what it is and some things that cause it. So evolution is a change in frequency in genes, and genes are traits. And over time, those can cause drastic changes or even just little changes. It's used to help explain how organisms diversified and how we have so many different types of organisms. Life on the planet started as single-celled organisms. You know, how did we get to the point we're at modern times? It helps to explain that. An example of what I mean by gene frequency is, like, you know, moths are a classic example, especially the peppered moths. If you look at the moth population, at one point there was a high number of genes or traits for the white coloration in the moth population. And then as the environment changed, white was no longer the successful trait, it no longer fit. And the dark population became more commonplace. And so as the white moths died, the black ones survived. They were able to reproduce and they passed on that trait. So when you look at the genes in the population now, there's more genes for the dark coloration of moth. And then those traits are inherited. So evolution works in that sense. These little changes over time, you know, affect a population. And for big changes, like we introduced the unit with whales, same idea. You have that kind of land-based, animal, Pachycetus, and you know, as it's going into the water and finding food and surviving a little better, the ones that could swim better, find more food, survive, pass on that trait. And those little changes just keep happening over millions of years. And then you end up with, you know, kind of modern whales, you know, and then the genes that are changing are location of nose, formation, the structure stays the same of the arm, but the shape of the arm changes into, you know, more paddle-like. So those little things change over time. And so there's a few things that cause this. There's the mechanisms of evolution. What causes the shift? And so there's natural selection, which we've talked about before. Organisms with trait that best fit their environment will survive, reproduce, and pass on that trait through their DNA. And fitness is what pops up, and it's used in a lot of different ways in culture. But for natural selection, it refers to how well something can survive and reproduce. So that's what fitness means. In common, you know, culture, it might mean like strength or speed or, you know, social Darwinism, talking about the way you conduct your life, kind of things like that. And it's been used for a lot of bad ways and things like that too. But the intention is, you know, this just helps explain a natural phenomenon. Things that you need variation in your population. If you don't have variation and the environment changes and your population can't keep up, you might die. The trait must be able to pass on and inherited. I always come back to my uncle who lost his arm. He lost his arm, so my cousins were stillborn with both arms, and, you know, one wasn't shorter than the other. So things that happen to your body might not necessarily affect your future offspring. The population must be able to reproduce. So if you don't have variation, or if you have variation and inheritable traits, if they can't reproduce for whatever reason or quickly enough, the population can still die out, go extinct. And then you need a pressure. You need something that causes the change, climates, predators, obtaining food, something that makes a difference in that trait being more successful than another. And so there's a few examples here. Here's just an example with some beetles. It kind of goes with the, they're a little easier to draw than moss. But the light colored beetles are going to be eaten. The dark ones survive and reproduce. So the variation was the color, the pressure in this situation was the predator. And so it changes. And oftentimes these graphs are used to represent these changes. You have the original population with more white or light colored genes. And then after the selection, the population shifts to more dark colored genes. And all that's labeled here. And then we use these trees. Sometimes they're called cladograms, depending on how they're set up, or phylogenetic trees if you're looking more at DNA. But you read them the same way. We have environmental change over time because it's natural selection. You have this ancient ancestor or the original. When the tree splits, that's where the common ancestor split. So, in my example here, I had split into herbivores and carnivores. Some species split again, and maybe they became extinct. So usually when the line doesn't make it to the top, that might mean extinction. Then you have some herbivores that can fly. So that's the next split, and versus land herbivores. And there'd be way more branches. This is a simplified example. But when we read these, this represents where the common ancestor split. So where they, they're still related, but now they're like a family tree, here's your cousins and, here's the other cousins and then second cousins and third cousins. And the further you split, the, less you're related, but you're still related at some point. Another type of selection that can cause evolution is artificial selection. And so it's artificial because humans cause or choose this trait. It's what we want to have happen. So it's different. So fitness is determined differently. So for example, we've done this to pretty much everything we've gotten our hands on. Animals, agriculture, everything that you eat from the grocery store has been modified by us. There's nothing that's really just wild, that you consume. So here's a couple examples of that, human choice over time. So it's a little bit different of an idea, but for dogs, we domesticated them from wolves. We chose them to be nice. And so the ones that were mean, tempered, went away in our choice. Wolves still exist, but the dogs we were breeding from them. Then, we wanted big dogs. And so we have this big dog part. And then, we have things with a snout, so it still have the long nose or snout, and then we have things with no snout, like a pug, the flat-faced dog. So we chose those traits when they were born, and we purposely bred them in, even if they're not good for the animal. Having no snout is not good. Usually those dogs have breathing problems, and their brain is squished, and there's lots of things that we breed into these animals that aren't necessarily good and would not help them survive. So artificial selection is humans choose the trait. Doesn't matter if it's a good one or not. It's our choice, and we make it happen through breeding. Same thing here. Here's another example. This Olicera plant, we developed many plants from it. We bred in ones with big leaves, and that gave us kale. We bred ones that make small flowers that don't necessarily bloom all the time, and that's broccoli. Kohlrabi has a large meristem. Kohlrabi is common in more European cultures, and it's like a food, but it's like a big, meristem, like a bottom stem, basically. So we choose the trait, so it's a little bit different. The last one we looked at is sexual selection, and this one always kind of bothered Darwin. Why are males and females different, and why are there these extravagant colors that don't necessarily help survival? And especially the peacock was always the example of something that bothered him. Not that he didn't like peacocks, but like it didn't help his explanation of natural selection. But sexual selection is organisms with traits that help them to attract mates, reproduce, or when mates pass on that trait, despite if the trait helps them survive or not. But the peacock having the large feathers does not help them escape from predators. So it doesn't fit the environment. So that's why it doesn't go with natural selection. But it does help them attract mates. Having a big, nicely filled out tail can indicate healthiness, a good diet, maybe low parasites. So it works to attract a mate. And you know, it's not just feathers. It can be dances, behaviors, horns on elk, antlers, the big mane on a lion. And it's not always males that are more ornamented. Females can be the colorful ones too. But most of the things we'll talk about, you know, males versus females, because, you know, most researchers are males and don't focus on females, unfortunately. But there's a couple of different ways this happens, and even one not listed. There's same-sex competition, so usually fights. So you see two males or two females fighting over a mate, that would be same-sex competition. Intersex competition sometimes is described as. And there's intersex competition. So this is usually trying to impress the opposite sex. So in the examples, there's the bowerbirds or the peacock spiders, things that dance to impress their mates, again, to show health or, you know, reliability, you know, something to, you know, get their attention. So this is what, you know, passes on the trait. You know, dancing with bright colors doesn't help you hide from predators, but it helps you attract a mate. And so here's a couple examples, you know, the reproductive advantage that trait gives you over time. So here's an elk ancestor, you know, maybe short antlers, they die out, but the large antlered males survive. There's some birds called meadowlarks, and there's eastern and western, and like appearance-wise, they look super similar, but their calls are different. So there must have been a group that, you know, liked the soft rattle call, and they're the western meadowlarks now. And then there's the eastern meadowlarks who like sharp single calls. So behavior can sometimes be what attracts females. And now they're two separate species because the eastern meadowlark females don't like the western meadowlark calls. The western meadowlark females don't like the eastern meadowlark calls. So now they're two different species. And then we can see that again, you know, here's another one of those graphs, and we'll talk about these in a second, but, you know, the original population of meadowlarks maybe had like a medium call, and a few had short calls, and a few had long calls, and then we look at the new population after selection. Now there's going to be more short-called ones, and they become the, you know, western meadowlarks, and the eastern meadowlarks, and the, you know, become the other one. So we see this split in the population. And there's a few graphs. You don't have to memorize the type of graph, but we're just trying to understand and be better graph readers in general. There's directional selection that moves towards one extreme variation. It doesn't have to be, you know, this way all the time, but, you know, here's the original population, maybe more lighter colored. And then after selection, it goes to the darker colored and the whiter ones die out. It could go the other way too. This is just an example. They're stabilizing, you know, it moves towards the middle trait. So it's still the beetles is what it's supposed to be, you know, white, gray, and black. Original population, there's lots of variation after selection, you know, maybe just the gray ones factored. So stabilizing means it moves towards the middle of the trait. And then disruptive is where it moves towards both extremes and goes away from the middle trait. So, you know, for whatever reason, white moths are successful, the gray ones are not, and the darker ones are also successful, but the gray ones go away, we can have this kind of split after selection. Both of these will result in a lower variation for a time. You know, in this one, the white ones and the dark ones are going away, so you're left with gray. So now there's less traits. In this one, there's pretty much just mostly white and black, so there's less variation. In this one, it's moving away from the white, so there's just darker colors. So selection events can result in lower variation for a short time, and then mutation and sexual reproduction can introduce more variation into a population.